Just tell me. So anyway, what you need to do is, Alan, I need you to put him against the cage, right? And then I want you to work the clinch, but on the separations. I need some elbows on the separation, okay?
Yeah. Let me put that in my phone.
Yeah. So I know you're going to be walking in here pretty soon. But yeah, I'm going to want you to bang, separate elbows.
Off
okay?
the clinch.
Yeah. Because clinch. Sometimes people don't look for elbows off the clinch, and I think sometimes that's a pretty smart idea.
Clinch is C-H-I-T.
Yeah,
okay.
C-H.
I always get messed up.
Hey, everybody, Karyn Bryant and...
What's up, guys? Alan Jouban here.
Yeah, so we're here at Black House. You know, Alan's got a fight coming up at UFC 236. I was just going over some things. Some stuff I wanted him to do against the cage a little bit. Just some work I'd like you to do off of the clinch is all.
No, I appreciate it. Between you and then Steven Seagal texting me, I feel very prepared.
Well, he did teach Anderson that kick. I mean, we're in the house that Anderson built, right? He did teach him that kick. So actually, yeah. Steven Seagal built Black House, right?
He's part of it if you look at it.
Yeah. Listen, folks, welcome to the show. Yeah, Alan just finished up wrestling practice with our buddy Kenny Johnson, who you'll hear from later on in this podcast. But so we figured it was worth coming here to talk to you. We'll get into your fight stuff too. But you're 2 weeks away.
2 weeks out. Starting to taper things off. This is my last week in town, and then next week we're off to Atlanta. I almost said Philly. Off to Atlanta and ready to rock and roll.
It's exciting, and we'll keep you posted on this too. I'm not working that show, but we're gonna probably be doing a big live party thing from Dave and Buster's up in Hollywood,
nice.
Which we'll be watching there, and then doing talking live afterwards and stuff like that. So just stay tuned to get more information on that. But it looks like we are gonna do that. I'm sorry I can't be there in person, but you know sometimes it's way stressful being in there when you're fighting.
I mean, you get to go to Dave and Buster's and drink alcohol and play.
That's true. I can't ever
teenager.
Drink. I know.
Watch fights.
I never get to drink on fight night if I'm working. Yeah. So it's crazy. But listen, I just got back from Philly yesterday. Fun fights. Ridiculous KO in the main event.
Man.
Like every time Justin Gaethje does it, you're sort of like, well, of it's a combination of, he did it again. Oh my God, he did it again. And of course he did it again.
And a very suitable name. You know, as Showtime Pettis has Showtime as his nickname, Justin the Highlight Gaethje is such a perfect name for him because he's a guy that you can never count out. He's always got some type of highlight finish. He jumps, flips off of the cage. He's must-see TV when he's inside of the octagon. He's a fan-friendly, fighter-friendly type of fighter.
For sure. Now, I actually did think, it's a tough call in that fight. I don't know who you thought. I thought Edson could have scored.
I was wrong.
I kind of thought Edson was going to get a head kick knockout or something, or I thought that he was going to be able to keep his distance a little bit better and kind of score more of his, which one of you guys hit me kind of things, right?
Yeah.
But Justin was very smart in keeping that pressure on him, and eventually he was able to score the big knockout.
You know, I thought the same thing. I was wrong about this one. I thought it was going to be Barboza. You look at Barboza's last opponent was Hooker, right? And you look at when we talk about toughness and well-rounded, Hooker is the definition of toughness.
Sure.
That guy was not going anywhere. He took all the leg kicks, the damage upstairs. He kept coming forward. And so when I broke down this fight, I was kind of thinking, well, shit, Hooker maybe doesn't have the X factor quickness that Gaethje has, but he's tough as nails. He's a long rangey guy. He's good everywhere. And Barboza had a tough time dealing with him. But Barboza was able to take him out. So I thought Barboza was gonna do the same here. But Gaethje, he comes out and he's out leg kicking Barboza, surprising us with that. And he's just got that X factor where he's hitting off the break and he's much, much more deceptively quicker than you would think he is because Barboza has got the quick twitch muscle fibers and everything, but Gaethje's deceptively fast, really, really quick.
Well, exactly, and also part of the reason is, too, is that Justin is an NCAA D1 All-American wrestler, right? But you wouldn't know that because he never wrestles.
He keeps it in his back pocket.
Right,
constantly.
So we talked to him about it, and you talk to his coaches about it, sometimes they want him to fight a little bit smarter, and part of it is that whole thing of, like, he's so fan-friendly, and it's such a crowd-pleasing style, what he has to kind of walk through anything to keep coming forward, but part of you is like, how long can you maintain a career like that? Like, hey, dude, maybe we should save you a little bit. Maybe you should wrestle. So for that, I thought if he was going to employ some wrestling, then that was obviously something that you can use against Edson that people have had success against him.
Yeah.
Obviously, Habib. But at the same time, you're always so glad that Justin doesn't wrestle.
Yeah.
Like, you're always so thankful for it. But I thought it was an incredible fight. Like you said, with the leg kicks, it was like, you give one, I give one, you give one, I give one, you give one, I give one. And there was a minute where you kind of thought, like, who is it just last man standing? Like, what's going to happen?
And how are they going to go five rounds?
Right.
It was a five-round fight. There's no way they were going to keep that pace for that long. Yeah, definitely you could... he could have, like you said, exposed Barboza in the wrestling department. He chose not to. But that punch off of the break, I think that was just instinctual. You know, he's the kind of guy that clinches up and is looking for the quick finish. I didn't really think that that was going to put Barboza out the way it did, because it was a punch off of the break, and it wasn't an arm punch necessarily, but it wasn't a fully turnover of the hips. It was kind of just a break and a punch, and it hit flush on the chin. He's a wild man inside of it. It's like not a lot to say other than, you know, I'll say this.
Yeah.
He said after his fight in an interview that he, after the wars that he has been through, not only throughout his career, but just in the UFC alone, he's been in about three, you know, pretty much every fight. But Michael Johnson, Eddie Alvarez, and Dustin Poirier.
Right. All wars.
Three bona fide wars. Right. Those are something that punches a hole in your ticket of a fighter every time you go in the ring. He said after that he maybe has about five of those wars left in him. But this Barboza fight, he did not consider a war. He considered it. He didn't take that much damage. He didn't even know if he had got hit in the face. And so he said, you know what? Even though it was a fight of the night type of fight, he didn't really take any damage.
No.
So we can count on seeing some more wars in the future for Gaethje in the near future in the octagon.
Well, for sure. And we should talk about who he might fight next, because now this whole thing, it's funny to me how it's turned into, and I don't even know if it really is a scandal because it's so silly.
I think it's silly too, to be honest.
It's so silly.
But it's fun to talk about.
But anyway, so he came to the desk with us after at ESPN, and all of us are like, oh my God, Justin, you're the man.
Yeah,
like, you know,
him.
It's like all this praise because he is the man. That was an incredible fight. So Paul Felder is working the desk with us. Paul Felder is in that division. Paul Felder and Justin Gaethje, on the night of the rankings, on the night of the fight, Saturday night, they were right next to each other in the rankings, number 8 and number 9, I believe. And so, obviously, that'll change, you know.
Gaethje 8, Felder 9.
Yeah.
Gaethje will probably jump up some, but they're still neck and neck.
Exactly. Gotcha. So at the time, though, and so after his last fight, Paul Felder had said in the octagon, he said, I want the winner of Barboza versus Gaethje. Now, he's already fought Edson Barboza, looking to either right that wrong, or Paul is a guy that, you know, is willing to go into a war. So he said it after his last fight. So now he's got Justin Gaethje up there. He's going to say it to his face. Like, you know what I mean? He's going to back up what he said, and he's going to ask for a fight there with him. So we go on about it. We're talking about it on the show, and we bring up the rankings and this and that. And Justin, you know, was being, they were both, I think, being very respectful of each other. Paul respectfully asked for it. Justin respectfully was like, I don't know, maybe I'm looking to take somebody higher. Totally understandable. But the fact that we addressed the possible fight between those two, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. And Paul is right there, and he's a stand-up guy. Cut to later on, we hear that, and I actually have my, I saw Ali in the bar at the hotel afterwards.
Really?
So I'm talking to Ali. Hey, Ali, how's it going? He says, I'm kind of mad at you. You stole Justin's thunder. I was like, what? He says, yeah, you stole Justin's thunder. You know, I'm mad at you. You guys shouldn't have, like, kept pumping the Paul thing in the interview. I was like, all right, well, that's really weird to me. If you think that, if that's your takeaway from that interview, is that we stole his thunder. I was like, well, sorry that you feel that way. That really kind of sucks, but I don't think that's what happened, but okay. So then got to, like, the next day when I wake up, I see this story by a friend of mine that said that I stole his thunder and all this stuff. So I get completely thrown under the bus for something.
It's interesting that you said Ali was the one that said to you verbally, you were trying to steal his thunder, or Paul was trying to steal his thunder, when that was also kind of the headline.
Exactly. So that was I heard that on Saturday night after the fight. I was like, I didn't think anything of it. So then it comes out that I don't really, honestly, I don't know how upset Justin truly is. I haven't spoken to him about it. Like I said, if he is really upset, that's a bummer, because we, all three of us up there, were just like, dude, you're the man, right? So that actually is what upsets me at the whole thing, is if he really is that upset by it, because that sucks. I wouldn't want that to be the case. So I had tweeted out and said, they put the story. I said, well, what's funny is that people think that we just, I'm out there just like freestyling, that I don't have producers, that we don't have a flow to the show. I then took that down, because now I feel like, okay, I don't want it to seem like I'm throwing the producers under the bus, because the producers don't tell me everything to say, right? I get a format, I write a script, I go for my script. But a lot of time we do have IFBs that tell you, hey, bring up this thing to Alan, or mention this, mention that. So honestly, I remember we're talking about the rankings. So, yes, of course, any word that comes out of my mouth on the air, I fully own. But I'm saying the overall storyline of, hey, let's look at the rankings. Let's talk about a fight between these two. This is something that we all agree on collectively. Do you know what I mean? So I guess my thing to feel like Justin felt so bad about that was a bummer, because it's something we all talked about. We knew we were to be able to have fun with it, and I'm upset that it came out, or that some people may have received it in the way that they did, whether they did or not, or maybe it's just Ali, I don't know. But the intention was never to, like, steal anybody's thunder.
It's really a damned if you do, damned if you don't type situation.
Exactly.
Because if this had not have gotten brought up, we're looking at the rankings, which Paul and Gaethje are both in, and these two men are sitting side by side.
Right.
It would have been an elephant in the room. And then if Paul had not brought it up, then afterward, the storyline would have been like, man, well, you call people out when they're not in front of you, but when they're in front of you,
right,
you don't say a word. And that would have been somewhat of a storyline.
Exactly.
So either way, there would have been heat on it, as long as you do things in a respectful way. Wade over here behind the camera, guys, sent me a call out from, who was that? Who was
Brandon Vera.
Brandon Vera and
Brandon
won.
Vera the most, called you out?
Brandon Vera called out.
His call out was so respectful.
The most respectful call out I have ever seen in my life.
Yeah.
If you guys haven't seen it, go and look it up. He was like, I would like to ask if you're not injured and I'm not injured and the date is available and we are okay in agreement that I would. It was the most respectful call out, and the guy shook hands and it was complete honor. What I'm getting at is you could get a lot of things done in life if you don't try to trash the guy and you do it in a respectful way. And I believe Paul always handles himself with class and respect. And again, if he did not say anything, it would have been almost awkward that the guys are side by side in the rankings and he had previously called him out and did not do so. So I don't have a problem with it. I get it. It's kind of like I said, damned if you don't, if you don't. There's going to be some heat on either side of it. But I don't think that Gaethje's the guy that really concerns himself with minor things like that. I think it's more so along the lines of people instigating it. He was brought up to him in the presser,
right,
so he had to react to it.
Right.
And then possibly his manager, as you said, his manager was Ali, was not cool with it.
Yeah.
His manager is a guy that's very verbally open out there, especially on Twitter. Puts words in your head. And so I think that's really the root of it. I think this is something that's going to be forgotten very quick. I don't think it's something that's that at least Gaethje will be hanging on to for a long time.
Yeah, I hope that's the case. And I've always gotten on well with Ali. But like you said, we all know Ali. He likes to stir the pot.
Yeah.
But I've always gotten on well with him and Justin. And so that's what I'm saying. It's a little weird. But I do want to make sure, like, people don't think, you know, because I love Twitter. But you know, you really can't express everything the whole way. So like I said, I then realized, like, oh, some people might misunderstand it, and then they'll just be like, okay, B, you just say whatever they tell you to say, which isn't the case. But I do have a job, and when your boss makes a suggestion about a storyline or maybe a conversation, if you generally do.
Yeah, and not to get into TV 101, but yes.
Right.
When she's up there, or anytime I've done jobs, we have people on the air telling us, carry that conversation,
right,
or see where this goes, or try this. So, yes, you know, a lot of times we're freestyling, or Karen's freestyling, or she's reading, but they are putting ideas out there. So you just have to take all that into account before you go and judge somebody so quickly of stirring the pot or whatever. But again, I think I looked at it on Twitter or some of the Instagram comments, and to me, in my mind, the majority of the people were like, I didn't really have a problem with it. It was done in a respectful way.
Well,
so I think that's how the masses kind of see it.
I should hope so. And also the fact is that they have active fighters on the desk for a reason. That's part of it. You know what I mean? That's literally how, like, Anthony Smith got his fight with John Jones.
Yeah.
Pretty much, like, being on the desk after.
Do you remember the Tony Ferguson and Kevin Lee?
That thing is legendary.
Kevin Lee ripped Tony apart, but he got the fight.
This is what I'm saying.
They know
what they're doing by putting people on the desk.
There's reasons behind this.
Exactly. And so just so people know, like, I do get a format. Anything that's up there, I own, and I write the script for my whole thing. But literally, sometimes they do say, yeah, why don't you guys go a little further with this and go a little further with that? And then to add on to it, at the end of the day, this is all live TV. Like, I literally, like, it's weird because you dump stuff, like, you keep it in your short-term memory, right? Mm-hmm. And then, like, as soon as the show is done, you're just like, hey, man, that was really fun. And then somebody's like, you said this. You're like, what? I did what? Because on live TV, you're like, I don't even understand
because,
what this happened.
Because, like, TV, it's still you in my mind.
Right.
It's still you. But TV, you got to be a little bit more on, a little bit more fun. You got to be able to take jabs. You got to make stuff interesting. And so when it's done, it's just like, cool, we're done. Shake hands. But if some people are holding on to that little thing that
you said,
it's like,
what?
Maybe you're not made for TV.
Buck up.
It's just fun.
There any comments, Wade? Are there for anybody?
Well, we got fans wishing you good luck, Alan. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, guys.
Wish you luck. And then we also have one here, Alan, a throwback.
Uh-oh.
Saying, From Luis21D. Alan, thank you for letting me know about Dylan Blue Cologne. I love it.
My pleasure, man. I just want you guys to go out there and smell good. smell good. Give you confidence and hopefully...
Smelling good now.
You know, get that bag that date that you're looking for that night. Bag that...
bag that date!
Bag that...
Hashtag bag that date.
Bag that trophy.
I like that one.
Good, I'm glad you're using... Keep buying that Dylan Blue, man.
Yeah, it's good stuff. It's good stuff. But anybody... I mean, because I'm curious... If people don't, we're going to move on, but how many, because again, I totally think this is a fake scandal, yeah. But
there's not a lot. Cool. You're saying don't worry about it.
Cool. Yeah. Good. It's ridiculous. At any rate, that wasn't the only amazing knockout, dude. Michael Johnson was winning that fight. Yeah. I think with Josh Emmett. Winning that fight, we're literally there screaming. Not screaming, we don't have a dog in the fight, right? But you're literally like, if this dude just sticks and moves, he's going to get the win. Like, Michael Johnson, great performance. He neutralized Josh Emmett. Just stick and move at the end here. Stick and move, stick and move, stick and... Oh, shh. My God. Dude. Laid out.
It was kind of... it was a beautiful knockout, first of all, by Emmett. It was set up very well because he was kind of jabbing the body, changing levels, keeping Michael Johnson guessing. And I remember watching the fight, thinking, like you said, sticking and moving. I'm thinking, Michael Johnson is so fast. His reaction time. Every time Josh Emmett would lead in with a jab or change levels, Michael Johnson had a lead hook that he was so quick with. And I remember thinking...
Fast.
God, it's so tough to deal with Michael Johnson in his quickness. He has deceptive quickness and very long limbs. But that kind of ended up being the downfall for him. He kind of bit on the fake a little bit too much. That overhand right came over the top, knocked him out. And can I discuss the real storyline about that knockout? That how did Emmett not get the bonus, Karyn?
Dude, I know.
How was that? They're talking about that's a knockout of the year candidate, but he did not even get a bonus on that fight.
But didn't he ask for it?
Did he ask for it?
I don't know if he might have asked for it.
He might have, because that is kind of, we've learned.
Remember, Alan, after you win by knockout next 2 weeks from now, don't ask for a bonus.
I'm not asking for shit. Yeah, you gotta kind of find a way to hint at it, maybe, but...
And I don't know if that's really, I don't know if that really is it.
But it is a bit of a curse. People that ask for it, it sends off the wrong energy.
It's tough to do.
They gave it to, and I don't want to take anything away from this fight, because this is a great finish by Craig against, I don't remember the guy's
Paul
name.
Paul Craig versus, you don't remember it because his name is Kennedy Nchukwu. Okay.
I'm going to go with Kennedy.
That's exactly right.
Craig
Tyron and Paul all week were like, okay, we're going to call him a man Kennedy.
I don't want to come off as a hater or a negative person. I don't have negative energy in me. But I was watching this fight, and I felt it was a very sloppy fight, in my opinion. A lot of Kennedy was doing a lot of really kind of weird stuff, and Craig was really he was really falling for it. He's like really timid, and it turned him into like he was pulling guard and stuff. And I was thinking, I had never seen Kennedy fight before, so maybe he had a tremendous amount of knockouts prior to that, but he was giving Kennedy way too much respect for, to me, what I did not see as a sharp offense in the striking department. But it was very much a striker versus a grappler. And then the finish, Craig locked up that triangle, Kennedy fell into it, got out, and then falls right back into it again. And in my mind, it was kind of a low-level finish in terms of the guy gave him the triangle. So props to Craig for the comeback. It was a beautiful finish, but, I mean, you look at a triangle finish that was kind of against a white belt on the ground in Kennedy, compared to that beautiful knockout over the toughest nails, Michael Johnson, you got to give Emmett the bonus on that one. I think they missed it on that one. He must have said something to disappoint the bigwigs.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know, because to your point, you know, Nchukwu is newer. He was on Dana White's Tuesday Night Contender Series. So he is greener, and I agree with you on the technique needs to be tightened up, needs to be cleaned up. So he is unorthodox right now and hard to deal with. And Paul Craig has a way of winning a fight sometimes, and then
kind of
it slips away.
Right?
It either slips away or he's losing and he pulls it together in the end. I mean... That was I'm not sure why, because if you think about it too, Jack Hermansson got an even faster submission over David Branch in the co-main event. And so
did he get a bonus?
I thought maybe he did, because Fight of the Night I thought went to Justin and
Fight Edson. Of the Night there.
I don't think Justin got two bonuses. I remember reading that graphic. But again,
another one. Justin could have easily got a double bonus.
Well, exactly. So maybe he did. Again, this is the live TV thing, like my brain remembers at one point. Oh, no, Jack did, because I told him live right on the show.
He got a bonus.
Jack did get a bonus,
That is a deserving bonus.
That
because
was.
To run through a high-level black belt in Branch
Hensel Gracie black belt.
And to, I mean, to Big Brother him, he put him on the cage. He put him in the position that is his go-to position. He took it. That was an incredible thing. That's a move that transition. For, it's almost like a back transition to a to arm in guillotine. Mm-hmm. Pedro Munoz, a former Black House fighter here, he does that beautifully. He always shows that technique. I think he's done that a couple times inside of the UFC. Yeah. But man, what an impressive performance by him.
For sure. Well, and that was the fun thing. And I'd never met him before. And what a lovely guy. You know, he's Norwegian, and you know, just so polite. And he, you could tell, he was thrilled to be there. We didn't steal his thunder, apparently.
No.
You know, he was, Paul.
you missed that one, Paul.
Yeah, Paul. Why didn't you call him out? No, Jack is so polite, and I've never met him before, and he was just all smiles, and he was just so happy to be there. You know what I mean? And what a lovely guy, and a force to be reckoned with. You know, we talk about how some of the people in the European circuit maybe don't get everybody's respect, and you know they kind of fly under the radar a little bit. But this guy just took out a former two division champion. You know, David Branch was light heavyweight and middleweight champ over at WSOF. So Jack is on his rise. He wants to get on the Sweden card. He's looking to fight a guy like a Weidman or something like that. So I'm just saying that he is a person that maybe people should start to spend a little bit more time paying attention to.
Big win by him.
If we could just give a shout out to Son of Sammy Davis. He just gave us a donation.
Son of Sammy Davis.
Son of Sammy Davis. Appreciate
that,
man.
That's nice.
Appreciate that.
Thank you. So yeah, the Emmett thing, I do think you're right that it was worthy of a knockout. I also am just amazed at a fighter spirit in general, what you guys do, but his in particular in coming back. If you look at the list of injuries he suffered after Jeremy Stevens' fight, like his face was messed up. Mm. There was a story out about how the hospital there didn't actually diagnose all of his injuries, so he had gone home. Then he finds out that, oh, the orbital's broken. I have this too. He had vertigo. His face, like he had all kinds of problems.
He's tough as nails, man.
Right.
He fought my buddy Christo Siagos, who trains here. Josh Emmett still kind of says that was one of his toughest fights. That was a war. Remember when Emmett first came into the UFC? I think his first win, he had broken his pinky or something. I remember after the fight, his finger was facing the completely wrong direction. He went through that fight. He toughed it out. That is a very tough guy. He was on the wrong receiving end against Jeremy Stevens that night. But, man, a huge, huge win over Michael Johnson. Like I said, a spectacular highlight finish that he didn't get the bonus that he's gotten.
And it's tough because I saw Michael when I was walking by backstage. Well, I knew he was going to be pissed because we knew he was going to win if he had just stuck and moved, right? So I saw him backstage and he was walking by and he was pissed, obviously. And I was like, Mike, it was really a great fight. And he just said some words that I don't usually like to say on the air, but that might have rhymed with ducks. And stuff like that. Like, it wasn't duck me, but it was, you know what I mean? It was duck.
Man, this could go different directions.
Because he was not happy.
Yeah. You can tell, man.
It sucks. Because Michael's so good. And, like, that's the thing. Like, even in the fight with Darren Elkins, different things, like, he'll be doing so well in, like, one little mistake, right? I mean, that's the whole thing, right? You guys can capitalize and stuff so quickly. And one little thing turns everything. So that was just a bummer. Michael, I think, does look really good at 45. I like him there. It's just a tough go.
Tough loss. No, I really like him. Every time I watch him fight, he's a scrappy guy. He's got great speed, long limbs, and he knows how to use his body type and his fighting style to his advantage. Yep. He fights very good with his style. He just got caught, man. It was a tough night for him.
You know who else you like to watch, Alan Jouban?
Who's that?
Karate Hottie.
Yes, I do. And I thought that was
Just got a little warmer in here. Dude, she looks so good.
She was good. I thought that was, again, not to throw anything at the Greg fight, great finish by him, but after watching that fight, I believe the Karate Hottie fight was next. Mm-hmm. And to me, it was almost like a breath of fresh air. It's like these women, high level, on all areas, on the feet, they were going back and forth. Yep. Karate Hottie, anytime she gets a hold of you, she likes to go that overhook around the head. She has a beautiful throw. Mm-hmm. Where she goes, she gets in that side mount position, and she stays on you. A lot of pressure. They spoke about it on the show that once she gets in that side mount position, is really tough to get off. And you can see she's strong and she's very flexible. Like when she was in the side mount, you can see her knees. She was almost doing
seated like
split.
Pose or whatever.
She's so low to the ground, hips on the ground, that she doesn't allow any room for you to get out of there, and she keeps the pressure. But I thought it was a very a great fight by both women, because I'm fans of both of them, but a well-executed fight by Karate Hottie.
Absolutely, and I thought she looked grittier than ever. You know, there was just times when she had side control, and she's dropping elbows. She was doing just more sort of
the small little
dirtier,
things
sneakier, not sneaky, that's not the wrong, but like more creative, little gritty, little dirty things in there to with more impact. You
Those
know what
are
I mean?
The minor things that separate average fighters from great fighters, because they know how to keep pressure, they know how to stay active, they know how to continue the damage. You're not doing one of them, they're doing all of them, and she showed that. I agree.
For sure, and what's interesting is that she was saying part of the reason that Michelle is able to was able to do that, right? So her husband, she trains a lot with her husband, and apparently he lets her go all out when they train, right? Because you know, so when you were wrestling, you were with Ashley, Carla, we're here today. You know, wrestling may be a little bit different, but when it comes to striking, a lot of time women have a hard time finding a partner to spar with who can really go with them, right? Mm-hmm. So maybe if there's only not enough women, you want fresh bodies all the time, right? You guys work it all. They don't always have a guy that will work with them. Maybe the guy feels like, I can't go too hard because I'll hurt you. And then maybe, you know, maybe or she can't go too hard against another girl, right? Mm-hmm. So sometimes the women don't have enough full bore, just all out practice. So she gets to do that with her husband. He lets her like fully drop elbows, I guess, just go for broke. So Michelle can tell what really works and what it feels like to really land it. And apparently that has made a huge difference because she looked better than ever. She looked awesome.
Why am I picturing her husband in one of those like canine dog outfits that they run and the dog like latches on?
Totally.
I see him in this like bubble wrap outfit where she's just pounding on him, dropping elbows.
Right.
But I get it. It feels good to, if you can imagine having a sparring partner, like you said, with wrestling, and they have headgear and all these paddings on and a chest shield and all this, and then you can work on just elbow in the face, elbow in the body, bringing them down. I agree. I thought it showed. I was watching her fight thinking, man, she looks really good. Her pressure is strong. She's dropping those elbows. She was hand on the face, disrupting the breathing, turning the head, hitting the body. She looked like somebody on the rise, somebody that wants to make a title run at some in the near future.
Right. Well, she's definitely asking for the title shot. I don't know if she's next because Tatiana Suarez and Nina Ansaroff are going to be fighting each other as well. And they, you know, Michelle is now on a 3-fight win streak, but Tatiana hasn't lost at all yet. You know, since winning
she's
the Ultimate Fighter,
man.
So she's a total beast. Nina's on a tear. So I don't really know if the winner of Nina versus Tatiana would be next. If Michelle is still 2 fights
Nina
away
is
or
Amanda's.
Not. Yes, Amanda's
okay,
girl.
So
yeah,
be and really
so
good fight.
Yeah, no, I mean. What a problem to have like a lot of badass women right now. So it's really cool. Obviously Michelle is beloved and so popular and people would love to see her getting that chance. But I don't think people, I think people also recognize how good Nina and Tatiana are too. So I don't know.
Bunch of great girls in the division, as you said. Michelle is somebody that I feel like is, I don't want to say this.
Well, she's a star.
She's a star. Yeah. That's a clean way to put it. She is a star. She is somebody who is making waves and promoting the sport and women's fighting outside of the octagon, and she's performing good as well. Because sometimes when we overly push these girls that are pretty and can fight, but then they start losing, it's tough. And all these girls have had that. Paige VanZant, Michelle Waterson has had her losses when she was being promoted, but now she's being promoted more than ever. She's fighting better than ever. I think it's great for her career, but great for the sport, great for the women's UFC division as well.
For sure. Well, there were also a couple of real, go ahead.
Just want to give a quick shout out to Kevin from Chicago.
Kevin from Chicago!
Just gave us a donation.
Hey, thank you.
And he wanted to point out that he didn't think it was great that DC was moaning in agony when Branch got choked out.
He got very emotional about it.
Oh, wait. I didn't really hear that bit.
DC was moaning.
He got upset that David. I might not have my.
What do you mean?
Like he was bummed.
Oh, on a commentary.
On the side, I guess he showed some emotion about. You know,
I mean, he's human. I mean, we're human.
But why is that, though? Is Branch and DC have some type of connection?
I don't know.
No, I didn't think so. Maybe he just felt bad for the dude losing like that.
Some people are saying, hey, he's human. Other people are saying, hey, you should keep it professional.
I can't speak to that. I didn't hear that.
I didn't pick up on it. Yeah. I don't remember hearing that either, but that's interesting to know. I'll have to go back and maybe check that out. Did he just give a donation? Or shut up.
Thank you.
Back to the real story.
Make it rain.
Appreciate it, brother. No, thank you, man.
But I also just wanted to point out, I just thought consistently, all the women's fights were great. Marina Moroes looked fantastic against Sabina Mazo. You know, Sabina came on strong in the third round. She kind of warmed things up. You know, she kind of found her rhythm. That was her UFC debut, and people talk about octagon jitters. I know Sabina is a very, very good fighter, and I think she'll be back better than ever.
Broken nose fight? fight or whatever?
Yeah. Well, no, that's Aguilar. Oh, so
I didn't see
so Sabina and but Marina Moroz looked fantastic. So good for her. But also Jessica Aguilar and Marina Rodriguez. That's the one that was a war. That was the feature prelim. Yeah. And you know, a lot of times you're going to think that Jessica was going to be out. She hung in there. I mean, she took a bit of a beating. But that fight, I just want to, in general, say how good I thought the women performed on Saturday. And Marina Rodriguez, definitely another one to watch for as well. Got to talk about your boy, though, Sheymon Moraes,
yeah,
who had a really good fight with Sodiq Yusuff. I thought it was 1-1, you know what I mean, going into the third. And I thought that Sheymon was winning the third until the takedown, and then it went to Sodiq.
Pretty accurate assessment, I think. I think that... yeah, I had Sodiq winning the first round. I thought that Sheymon edged out the second round. It was It was a very close round, but I went with Sheymon on number two. Yeah. And then it was a very close third round up until that big punch landed from Sodiq. Sheymon handled it well. Sheyman's my guy. He trains here at Black House. Mm-hmm. He's a great guy, great fighter. He's got a little boy as well that he fights for. I can relate to him a lot. He fought a great fight, a very competitive fight. I was so impressed with his composure. The entire fight, he just cool, calm, collected. Yep. Even when he was hurt, he was like, nah, I've been here before. You could tell he's a professional, a guy that's been in a lot of fights. He's not showing that emotion. Sucks that he lost. Great fight, though. Nothing you can hang your head over, and nothing that's going to really hurt his credibility. Mm-hmm. On the other side, Sodiq. Star in the making,
totally.
I think
so,
you know,
too.
He looked amazing. Sheymon is a guy that's very stocky, very built for that division. Sodiq looked just as strong.
Dude, the thighs on those two guys.
I couldn't
guys.
Stop looking at his legs. I mean,
when you can't stop
looking at another guy's legs, it means that there's something happening there. The guy has humongous quads. Very strong when they entangled up, because me and Sheymon work a lot in a clinch, and he's very strong in the Thai plum clinch, kind of elbowing inside. You can see there was a battle going on, and Sodiq was able to handle himself very well. I was very impressed with him. Not only did he look great, he said somewhat it wasn't his best show, so I'd be very curious in seeing his best show. But with the kind of the rise of the African fighters at the moment, he is another one that puts his name on that list. It's great timing for him with the Usman becoming the champion on the card that I'm fighting. Stylebender could be an interim champion, and now Sodiq kind of throws his name on that list as one of these guys as well. So it only helps the possibility of a possible show in Africa one day.
And
having all these guys, it's great to see these guys kind of rising to the occasion when they get the opportunity.
Absolutely. Well, a couple of funny things about the Sheymon situation, and we're going to actually, like we mentioned, Kenny, the wrestling coach here, we have a fun clip with him in a second. But so a couple things about the Sheymon fight, because I thought it was a very good performance, and I too noticed, actually, Paul and I were at the desk, all three of us were talking about how Sheymon, was so composed and never really gave anything away and just really, looked like a real pro in there. I don't know if you saw, there's a couple of those nights. Up elbows and stuff.
I was talking about it this morning, man.
So good. But so one thing that was interesting, I was in the elevator back at the hotel. I ended up in the elevator with Sodiq, grabbed a little selfie.
I saw that,
I agree with you, total rising star, and what a lovely guy. So it seems like a real nice guy. But he said it to me. He said, I didn't know he was going to be that tough.
Yeah.
He said, I got to be honest with you. We weren't expecting him to be that hard. That was a much harder fight than I thought it was going to be. Which, I told Sheymon, because Sheymon actually came here at the end of your practice here. I told him that myself. It's small comfort when you still lose the fight, but that's still a very positive
Knowing
thing.
Knowing that the respect was there on the other
respect was there, and Sheymon didn't take any damage. He's like, I'm ready to go again. I didn't get hurt, and it, I don't think it diminished his stock. I mean, yes, it's a loss, but it was a great fight and all of that. But your boy Sheymon almost got left behind in Philly, because as we were getting on the shuttle in the morning, bunch of us are on there. I'm on there, T-Wood's on there, your Faber's on there, Castillo and Kenny Johnson, of course, is all of us heading back west. A lot of us are flying around the same time. So you get in the bus thing, and we're about to relieve from the place, and all of a sudden we're pulling out of the parking lot, and all of a sudden your boy Kenny's like, oh, hold on. hold on, wait, driver. And the guy doesn't hear him at first, and so he gets up and he's walking. He's like, yeah, my man just ran in for some bacon. He's like,
Sheymon?
Hold on a second, because his bag was already on the bus and everything like that, but Sheymon ran back in to get some bacon, or whatever. And
fighter.
Dude almost got left behind over some bacon, yeah. So then he comes like running out. Could you imagine you're like stroll out of the building like, oh no, like the bitten's
for some
gone.
Bacon. I'm surprised Kenny didn't have any in his Louis Vuitton fanny pack because Kenny's a professional flyer. I know he wouldn't get left behind.
But I had to crack up because then all of a sudden, so then we circle back around the building and here comes Sheymon trotting out. We're like, it's all for some bacon.
Well, good. I guess he was unscathed. After every fight, I could barely put my shoes on, much less run after the bus that's leaving. I know what Sodiq meant when he said he was tougher than I thought. Maybe he didn't mean stylistically or ability, but what I think he meant by that is every time, like I said, me and Sheymon get in here, he's a guy that he's just strong. Yeah. And when you go in and get some, he just elbows are, and things are just landing and you get done and you're like, man, I'm all banged up. Like, and that's the kind of, that's what he brings to the octagon. I'm sure that Sodiq felt a lot of that inside of there, and that's probably what he was referring to.
For sure. Cool. All right, well, let's take a look here, because Kenny, he's been your coach for quite some time here. Earlier today, he was working with Lyoto, Carla Esparza, Ashley Evans-Smith, among others here. So he always gives you guys a pep talk after.
Yeah.
But so sometimes we like to kind of reel him in for something for us as well. Kenny kind of keeps it real, so take a listen.
All right, hey, MMA Heat's back in the building at Black House. It's Kenny Bull Wrestling. We just had a great practice today. Alan Jouban's getting ready for his fight in Atlanta. We got Carla Esparza going to be in Florida. But what's more important is Wade and Karyn's in the house of MMA Heat. Today, some of the things we're going to keep it real with is, keep it real with how much you're on Instagram, you fucking asshole. So if you spent as much time sprawling or throwing a jab as you did on Instagram, you might be the best wrestler in the whole universe. You know, if you're worried about your sponsors and your Instagram and what you look like and all this, you know what? All you gotta do is win fights. I've seen a lot of pretty people that can't fight. They're not getting sponsors. If you knock some people out, the sponsors will call you. You know what? It doesn't matter how many posts you put on Instagram, it's not gonna make you a better fighter. But I bet you, if you're a great fighter, there'll be a lot more posts about you. So you know what? If you wanna keep it real, do more training and less Instagram. It's called screen time. See how much time you're on Instagram versus how much time you're really in the training facility. I don't even need to see your screen time. It's evident. If you can't sprawl, you're an asshole. If you can't throw a punch, you're an asshole. And if you know how to recover guard or get something off your back, you're an asshole. Don't be an asshole. I'm out.
Kenny.
That's my man.
I mean, he makes a solid point.
You know what he's good at? He's a coach, and he knows how to motivate you and stay focused, but he also knows how to enjoy the journey, man. He's always got a little bit of humor and whatever he's trying to motivate you with, but that's why I like him.
Absolutely, but it is true. I think about that. If I spent X amount of time doing this instead of that, how much further along could I be on something? But, Kenny always makes a good point. But listen, Alan, obviously, your fight is coming up, so before we get out of here, what can you tell people? It's UFC 236, you're fighting Dwight Grant.
Yeah, Dwight Grant, real quick about him. He's about 2 to 3 fights into his career, and when I look at him, the three things that jump off of the page, he's got good athletic ability. He's pretty quick on his feet. He's got long limbs, long arms, long legs, kind of a shorter torso. So he's kind of guarded very well because his target area, the torso, is small, arms are very long. So I got to find a way to get in there. And then he carries power. His long limbs make the punch go a long way, but his quickness makes up for it. And when the punch does land, he has knockout ability. He knocked out his last opponent in a pretty impressive fashion. So I just need to stay with aware of all that. And when anytime I'm doing sparring and everything, I'm taking that into account. Mm-hmm. I'm imagining this long limbs power. I'm moving in and out. I'm prepared. You know, Demetrius Johnson said it pretty well after his win in 1FC. He said, I prepare myself mentally for adversity. That way, when adversity happens in a fight, I'm not shocked. I'm not thrown off the pattern. That's the same way I prepare myself for this fight. I'm prepared for adversity. I'm prepared for a 3-round war. My goal is to finish this guy in the second round. He hasn't been finished yet. I'm coming off of a 14-month layoff. I honestly feel like my body is back to where it needed to be. Like, I took 5 years of aging off. Now that I have some things fixed, I just got to go in there, execute. They put me on pay-per-view. They put me and him on pay-per-view because there's a reason behind it. They know this guy has knockouts. I've got knockouts. If somebody doesn't go to sleep, it will be an exciting fight with two guys that like to strike, like to get in there. I just got to go in there and make it happen. But I'm excited. excited for the opportunity to go and remind the fans what I bring every time I step in there. That's it.
Yes. Also, I mean, you knocked out a lanky guy named Ben Saunders.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's not that you can't handle somebody who's got that lanky body.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I'm used to it. I kind of sometimes prefer length because it gives me more area to hit in terms of like leg kicks and stuff when they have long legs. I think that if I'm comparing the two guys, my opponent now has a little bit more speed, a little bit more power than Ben Saunders. Yeah. But Ben Saunders had other areas that he was strong.
Yeah.
But nonetheless, man, I'm just ready to get in there and do it. 14 months has been way too long. And when you're out from injury, it's almost like taking a loss in terms of momentum.
Yeah,
the vision carries on without you. I need to get that momentum back with a big type of win and put me right back there and close to that top 15 slot.
Last question, how are you going to wear your hair?
I'm going to clean it up, but I'm not going to go full on hard line.
No.
Old school Brahma mode. I'm going to go with a little bit of a cleaned up look. I appreciate you asking.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it matters. It's important.
This is important
right
here.
People, it's important.
Important teeth.
Awesome. Well, like I said, what happened?
Just two shout outs. One to John, who just made a donation.
Hi, John. Thanks
thank
for the donation.
Brother.
We appreciate
that,
it.
Man.
And one to your mom.
Oh, hi,
hey,
Mom.
My mom.
How are you? So last time my mom was in the building when you fought. Actually, that Ben Saunders fight in Florida. So I'm happy you're on the pay-per-view because I like you getting pay-per-view. Unfortunately, I won't be there. But my next fight that I'm working is I'm going to Russia. So I'm doing the Russia card, and then I'll be on the shows in Florida as well. So
Mother Russia.
I know. It'll be really fun. So on Instagram, I'm KB Heat. You can follow MMA Heat everywhere as well. And on Twitter, Karyn Bryant all across the board. Where can they find you?
At Alan Jouban across all social media. Subscribe to my YouTube channel. I do a show called Unguarded. Check that one out.
See you next time.
Take care, guys.
#ThereIsNoScandal.
There's no scandal, guys.
Slow news day.